Good evening. Thank you everyone for joining us under the big top for Night at the Circus. Tonight's event is brought to you by the SJSU Special Libraries Association student chapter. My name is Leslie Perry and I'll be the ringmaster tonight. We are especially excited for this program. We have three incredible speakers from libraries across the country, a true three-ring circus. They will be talking about topics related to special collections and archives, preservation, performing arts librarianship, music, material culture. It's gonna be a terrific evening. We'll hear from each guest and there will be time for a quick Q&A after each of their presentations. And then for the grand finale, the blow off, we will witness the gravity defying limb contorting feats of one of our own executive committee members and fellow students. First up tonight, we are so excited to welcome Christina Taylor Gibson. Christina is an American Bandmasters Association project archivist, working in special collections in performing arts at the Michelle Smith Performing Arts Library at the University of Maryland. Her professional focus is on digital humanities outreach and diversity and inclusion in the archive space. Christina is an established music historian with over 15 years of classroom experience and a scholarly record on 20th century musical exchange between the US and Mexico. Christina is on East Coast time tonight, so this presentation has been pre-recorded, but she is here to answer questions when it concludes, so you can enter those into the chat box and we will welcome her here afterwards. Thank you so much, Christina, for being here.
Hello. I'm so happy you've decided to join us to learn more about Merle Evans and circus music. I'm Christina Taylor Gibson. I'm the American Bandmasters Association project archivist. I work in special collections and performing arts at the University of Maryland. I want to begin by thanking Gabrielle Visco for inviting me here to speak. And I'm so happy to share my work with the San Jose State University Special Library Association student chapter. Please feel free to email me after the presentation if you have any questions or want to learn more about our collections. Hello. So many of you probably went to the circus as a child. I know I did. And there are a lot of things to think about when you go to the circus, a lot of sensory overload, right? And I wanted to begin by kind of dissecting what some of those things are. You often have animals and animal trainers. You have performers, you know, a high wire act, some sort of gymnastics or acrobatics going on. You've got food, peanuts and french fries and hot dogs. You've got a crowd, a big tent. There's often a circus train that brings everybody in and some sort of parade or something. And then you've got the music. Sometimes that music fades into the background. My purpose today is to bring the music of the circus a little bit more into the foreground so that we can think about what that music does, how it operates, how we might enjoy it better. Circus music has some really particular characteristics, and we'll talk more about those characteristics in a few minutes. But just to get us started, I wanted to play for you a circus march. This circus march is by Carl L. King, and it's Barnum and Bailey's favorite. And you can get a sense for what circus music is like from this march.
Oh, so, so sorry.
So many of you probably... All of the photographs and most of the materials that I'll be talking about today are from the Merle Evans papers. Merle Evans was the band leader of Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus from 1919 to 1969. So that's 50 years. So in his collection of materials, we really have a lot that tells us about the musical history of circus music in the 20th century. So that's going to be our springboard for figuring out how music functions in the circus. One of the reasons that the Merle Evans papers came to the University of Maryland, and one of the reasons that I take care of those papers, is because Merle Evans was a member of the American Bandmasters Association. You have to be elected into the ABA. It's a very prestigious society of band directors, and he was elected in 1947. It's a fairly substantial collection among our band collections, comprising 39.5 linear feet. It includes correspondence, programs, photographs, music. We have some clothing. You'll see a picture of some hats at the end of the presentation, and some instruments. And I've included the stable URL at the bottom of the slide, which you can copy and paste into your browser if you want to learn more about our band collections and about the Merle Evans papers specifically. There are three questions that I am using to guide my presentation to you today. I consider them through lines, ways of shaping what I have to say and what I have to offer, and tools for you to shape what you hear and how you interpret it. So the first question is, how does music function in a circus? So circus music is music written for a purpose. It's performing a particular function. And I want to take some time and figure out what that function is. What is it doing for us? The second question is a cultural context question. How do circus musicians operate within the larger culture? What is their role? What is their status? What kind of class characteristics would we expect from a circus musician? What kind of ethnic orientation do we expect from the circus at large and from the circus musicians? Are there some other questions that we should consider about where the circus and where circus musicians are within the larger universe of musicians? The third question is probably the most relevant and important for a student group, which is, how do I describe my responsibility toward this material as an archivist? And how might you imagine your role toward this material if you had my job? So we'll talk a little bit about that too. There are three questions. If you've ever been to a movie or watched a TV show and paid attention to how the music is functioning, you'll notice that there's a lot of music going on that's manipulating your emotions or allowing you to move from scene to scene that isn't really super present in your experience of this movie or this TV show. And a lot of circus music is that same way. It just kind of hangs out in the background and sets the tone, invites you to move from act to act, kind of helps make it an experience worth remembering. In a second, we're going to look at a circus program and dissect that a little bit. But right now, just envision that circus experience in your head, especially maybe one before your generation. So as the circus came into town on the train, you would often have a parade. And that parade would signal to people that the circus was there, that there were going to be circus performances. It also took people from that train station into the circus grounds where you were going to go to the performance. When you come into the circus tent, it's the music that signals to you, you know, when it's time to chat with your neighbors and when it's time to start to pay attention. It gives you some clues as to what kind of event this is going to be. And then we have some really great studies that are telling us that music in the movies, in TV shows, and in circuses is also smoothing out the motion. Well, this is really critical in a circus environment because if you have people on a high wire and they're, you know, wobbling a little bit, the rhythm of the music can help you feel like they are gliding just really smoothly along that wire. So this is the sort of elision that music can provide for our mental processing of what is happening in the circus. And it's really crucial for what the kind of illusion that the circus is trying to present. So as I already mentioned, it's also going to be, you know, taking you from act to act. And it's also just something people expect when they go to the circus. That's why they don't think about the music, because it's just part of going to the circus is hearing music. To really understand how circus music functions, we have to understand what circus music is. And this is a subgenre of wind band music. So that prescribes for us a certain instrumentation. That is brass instruments plus percussion. Wind band music in the US comes out of the Civil War. That's when we see this huge explosion of wind bands. And they're derived from these military bands that helped soldiers cheer up, help soldiers feel sad, help soldiers move from place to place. And the Civil War soldiers came home. They knew how to play these instruments. They wanted to keep playing them at home. And so then we see this explosion of town bands and genre bands like the circus band. Because it's a subgenre, there are certain specific characteristics to circus music. It's mostly bright and cheerful in major keys with trilling flute and piccolo lines. This is the sort of thing that you probably observed in the Carl King example that I played for you earlier. It has this really fast pace, this whirling sound, and sometimes it's translated into an organ or an organ plays along with it, and that kind of adds to this sense of displacement that the music can give you. As we've been discussing, it's programmatic. It's there for a reason. It's performing a purpose. And because it's performing a purpose, you'll hear it change if the purpose changes. So for example, often there's like an act of exoticism. So for an exotic act, you will probably hear that music switch in from the major, cheerful, happy music into minor, contemplative, dangerous music. You can imagine the scare quotes that I've got around that word when I say it. And similarly, you are going to have kind of some surprises or unexpected things to symbolize silliness if you hear clown music. And that's what I have here for you today.
Thank you.
to really understand. It helps me visualize how music is functioning in a circus to have a circus program in front of me. This is just the first two pages of the program, and in a second, I'm going to flip to the next slide and you'll see the second two pages of the program, and we'll talk a little bit more when we're there. But just in these first two pages of the program, there are some interesting things that we can observe. First of all, there are a couple spots, and you see them marked with those blue arrows, where music is explicitly mentioned in the program. So we know, for example, that there's going to be a real focus on music at the very beginning of the program and at display 10, where you have the enchanting ethereal extravaganza. We know that there's going to be some focused music there. But I don't think we are meant to believe, and I certainly don't believe, that there's no music going on in between those two moments. I'm almost certain we're going to be hearing some music during the acrobatic artistry, for example, and probably at least punctuating music during the amazingly accomplished animals, aerial incredulity, peerless performing proboscideans, right? There's gonna be music there too. They just haven't taken the time to mark that on the program. Another thing I want to observe about this music, the music that is marked on the program is ascribed to the producer, John Ringling North, one of the Ringling brothers. I am skeptical, based on what I have read about Merle Evans and the Ringling brothers, that this is music actually composed by John Ringling, but I don't know that for a fact. And so this gives us some clues about status and who's allowed to claim authorship in this context. Certainly the music that Merle Evans is providing is not at all, you know, marked on the program. So just wanted to plant that seed in your mind. So here on the third and fourth pages of the program, we again see that music is mentioned explicitly only three times, and they are big moments in the program, and we certainly can expect to hear a lot of music at those moments. The large pageant leading into the intermission, and then the moment when all the clowns are in the ring at the very end of the program. But again, there are acts mentioned here where we would expect to also hear music, and music is just not included in the program. It so retreats into the background that it's not even mentioned here. I think, for example, the tumbling act would be one where you would probably have music, and the tightrope walkers is another moment when you would probably have music, because music would help you convey what you are trying to do. On the left of the screen, you see an image of a photograph from the Merle Evans papers. This was taken in 1909, and it's from the S.W. Brundage shows. So these were shows that Evans was in before he joined the Barnum and Bailey Ringling Brothers Circus. I love this image because to me it conveys so much about the class and cultural context of the circus in the early 20th century. So you have to understand that Merle Evans was from a working class family. And most of these folks that he was performing with And in fact, many of the folks who were coming to see the circus were also from working class or middle class families. There's a lot of glitter and pretend glamour that goes on at the circus, but there's also a lot of hardship that's in the background of the stories of these performers here. There are some ways in which that issue of class ties into issues of race and ethnicity within the circus and within the larger context in which the circus exists. I can't tease all of those out in this presentation, and there, you know, frankly, if there's someone who's looking for some scholarly research, I think there's plenty of room here for more really rigorous research in this area. But on the surface, here are some things that we know. First of all, I mentioned earlier that there were exotic acts, and those were absolutely standard in the circus, and frankly, were standard in a lot of popular music performances in the 19th and 20th century. And so this is really exhibitionism that in our current cultural context might make us quite uncomfortable, but was very, very commonplace. So in the Merle Evans biography, you hear descriptions of, for example, families being brought from the west coast of Africa to be displayed in the circus. And the act that they are featured in is basically these people standing there and having people examine them, right? So culture on display. You can observe in this photograph that on the far left of the photograph, we have a man in cross dress, right? And that would be commonplace, part of the humor and the show of these performances. So we can have a more extensive conversation on what that means in terms of how we understand gender and class and performativity all intersecting here. The other issue that I wanted to bring up very purposefully was that circus music, like I said, comes out of this 19th century wind band tradition. Another genre, popular genre, that comes out of the 19th century wind band, military band, is the bands that played for minstrel shows. Again, this is one of those topics that we often tiptoe around when we talk about music in the US, but in my opinion, it's a real mistake, right? Because minstrel shows were the most popular form of entertainment for large chunks of the 19th century. And so they affected every other adjacent form, including the circus band, including most popular culture that you enjoy today. And so these features that I'm talking about, cross-dressing, exhibitionism of foreign people or exotic people, musical devices that signal this sort of strangeness or primitiveness or foreignness, these were part and parcel of the minstrel shows. And many of the performers who were performing in the circus band when it was off season for the circus would bounce over and play for a minstrel show in blackface. So you really have to understand that all of these popular forms are related, that there is this communication between high art and low art that is happening in these forms, and that somebody like Merle Evans, who comes from a working class background, finds himself performing for middle class audiences and then aspiring to elite membership in something like the American Bandmasters Association, is walking his own sort of tightrope. And his performativity in all these different circles is interesting to watch and observe because it tells us a lot about the culture at large during the time period. So Gabrielle asked me to talk a little bit about my job and my role at the University of Maryland at the end of my talk. So I'm really happy to have the chance to do that. And it might be interesting to you all since many of you are students. So my job title is American Bandmasters Association Project Archivist. I work on the band collections at Special Collections and Performing Arts, which is part of the Michelle Smith Performing Arts Library at the University of Maryland's Clarice Smith Center. Let me translate that for someone who is not familiar with the University of Maryland. What that means is that our repository is located within a performing arts library, and the performing arts library is located within a large building that also houses a school of music and a school of theater and performing arts. So the people that we are serving are right there in the building with us. Our mission is to acquire, preserve, and provide access to research materials that document performance instruction and scholarship consistent with the university's performing arts educational objectives. The mission is simultaneously very specific and very broad, and it allows us to do some really fun and creative things with our population because they're right there in the building. Many of our student workers come from the disciplines that we serve, and we have a lot of allowance to explore freely within those disciplines and do the sort of outreach and innovation that responds to current curricular needs. The American Bandmasters Association records and the personal collections of bandmasters comprise over 1,200 linear feet. That's about a third of our collection by my calculation, so it's a significant part of the collection. We're lucky in that the ABA is not just funding my position, but they're a real partner in creating history around band music. And so we find that band folks come to our repository to do research. Band folks are checking up on what we're doing to preserve the collections and how the history of band music is being told. So we're very fortunate to have that close partnership. If you want to explore more about who we are and what we do, I've provided a link at the bottom of the slide. And certainly if you have any questions for me, you can be in touch. So Gabrielle.
All right, Leslie.
Well, thank you so much, Christina. That was fascinating. I'm gonna open up the floor to questions, if anyone wants to jump in. You can just enter it into the chat box. I have a question myself. And it's about the kind of practice of voyeurism with bringing people from foreign cultures to sort of be displayed. I'm just wondering about the origins of that in kind of American entertainment and if it's connected to the World's Fair, and also if music that they brought from their countries, from their cultures, gets incorporated into the circus in any way.
So I don't have a clear answer for you on either of those. I mean, I know that this sort of exhibitionism dates back to the very beginning of colonialism, right? How it made its way to the circus particularly, I don't know, but I do know that it shows up in all kinds of popular culture. And then the second part of your question is whether the music influences. So what I hear as a musicologist happening more than the particular music of folks who were incorporated into the circus, influencing circus music, there are these kind of stereotypes that often are put onto exotic music of all different kinds. And that's more what I hear happening, is that those stereotypes follow different types of people as they come into the circus. There are a couple questions in the chat. So can I just go ahead and respond to those?
Absolutely.
Okay, so first of all, the
Maureen Brunsdale's comment about John Ringling North, I'm sure she's right. So the sources that I'm using are a biography of Merle Evans and then the Merle Evans papers. And he had a sometimes difficult relationship with the Ringling brothers. And so there is bias in there. And so, you know, I don't claim that they're 100% accurate. So how did I get interested in this topic? So I'm trained as a musicologist, not really specializing in band music. I got this job because of my background in music and because I was interested in archival work. And then I've learned about the history on the job. So, and it is fascinating. So just curiosity got me here. And that answers Allison's question as well. Do I have a particularly favorite circus music song? Well, you know, the Gladiator song we listen to, the clown music, is really fun. It's classic. I don't know that that's a particularly innovative choice, but it's a really fun one. And in terms of our collections, we have a whole bunch of Carl King's music. And the early part of that music is circus music, and it's all really kind of funky. So that stuff's really fun. How do we acquire music and other materials? For the most part, since I've been in the job, folks have come to us. Again, we have this really close relationship with the ABA, and we're very present at their meetings, and we make sure and let them know what we do. The curators sometimes do contact stuff for donations, but we also get approached quite a bit. Yeah, I love Leslie's question. So that's also been interesting for me coming from a research background, because I would say, like, researchers doing really intense scholarly research are the exception rather than the rule for these collections. So we get a wide range of researchers. A lot of them are like students of particular bandmasters wanting to know more about their teachers or about the community around a particular personality. Or there are a lot of bandmasters who in retirement have these pet projects that they are pursuing, or you'll get someone who wants to create a resource for the band community. History in this area is a growing field, but not really, I would say, dominant among our researchers.
It sounds like there's minimal amount of jobs in that field, though, with just circus libraries. Would you say that's accurate?
Well, so I'm a bandmaster archivist. I don't really know the range of circus libraries. So maybe one of the other speakers can respond to that a little bit better than I can. But I think anything where you have, you know, specialized knowledge and specialized researchers, there's going to be a smaller universe of repositories, but they're going to have particular types of materials, right?
Yeah, special libraries in general.
Yeah.
Did anyone else have a question for Christina? I think that's about it.
Christina, thank you so much for being here tonight and for presenting this. Really appreciate your generosity.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm going to stick around as long as I can last.
Okay.
This is my second conference of the day. So that's why I pre-recorded this. You know, I might not make it all the way, but I'm going to try.
Thank you
so much.
All right. Next, we are thrilled to welcome Maureen Brunsdale, Special Collections Librarian at the Milner Library at Illinois State University. Born and raised on a farm in North Dakota, as a girl, Maureen never imagined she would one day become a circus librarian. She earned her degrees at St. Olaf College, University of Iowa, go Hawkeyes, and University of South Dakota. She spent years serving as everything from distance education librarian to government documents librarian to access services librarian before finally landing the job that no one else seemed to want, special collections librarian, in 2008. Since that time, she spent years advocating for all four of the collections under her care, none more unique or spellbinding as the Circus and Allied Arts Collection. We can't wait to hear about it. Please welcome Maureen.
Thank you so much.
Maureen, you're on mute.
Oh, no. Dang, it's been a long day. I was here as well. But thank you so much for inviting me to be with you today. I love spreading the gospel according to Circus to people far and wide. And, you know, the previous speaker mentioned just how multifaceted Circus is, and I can't beat that drum any more strongly than that. But let me start with a question for you all before we get into the pictures in my presentation. How old do you think Circus is here in the United States? How far back does it go? Let me
about
see in chat.
Years.
I'm sorry?
Maybe 50 years or more, a little more.
1800s, I'm seeing, 200 years. At least 200 years. 1800s. Okay, the answer is 1791. Woohoo! What? Yeah, 1791, and it was started by a guy by the name of Ricketts, John Ricketts, and I am delighted to tell you that just 3 years ago or so, I was in the vault of Special Collections and happened upon this dusty tome, and lo and behold, it was John Ricketts' music from when he was at his circus in Scotland in 1790. So very likely I have in our collection the first music that would have been played in 1791 by John Bill Ricketts on the East Coast in a hard circus in a building. I know, it's so cool. You can't, mind-blowing stuff. Let me cartwheel back a little bit to tell you how I got into it. So I wanted to be a farmer when I grew up, and a major drought kind of changed my plans. And I decided, you know, what else am I gonna be? I'm gonna be a librarian. And my friends had interventions before interventions were cool and said, don't do it. You laugh too much. You're too loud. You know, the list went on and on. And I was like, no, I can do it. And I went to library school with the idea of being a special collections librarian. I had no idea that a circus librarian thing was out there. I came to this job, as my introduction said, through a variety of different jobs. My friends say I couldn't hold a job very long, but the truth is that I got bored in jobs very, very easily. And so I would change jobs as I got bored, honestly. And in 2008, the library was undergoing a very big reorganization. And the associate dean came to my office and knocked on the door and said, hey, you know, we've got a number of people retiring. Could you take geography, geology, and military science as subjects and be the subject librarians for those areas? And I thought, well, gosh, other than having a name misspelled for the Marine Corps, always, and or moraine, a geological moraine, I don't know much about those things, but sure, I'll take it. And he said, great, thanks. And he jumped up from my chair and started walking away. I'm like, wait, what about special collections? And he turns and he looks at me and he says, well, no one wants that. What? I want it. So I got up there and it was special collections had been since the 1980s, a place where people went to end their careers. So they went there in their final years of librarianship and, you know, they retired. It was a part-time gig usually, and it just kind of grew in a very unorganized way. And so I started putting things in order, and I learned very early in my doing so that one of our largest donors had a scrapbook, and it was the type of scrapbook that our grandparents or great grandparents had, with the black pages and the white, you know, the black and white photos and the white pen on the black pages. And I sat down with one of those scrapbooks, and it was dated 1913. And I thought, well, that's kind of neat. You know, let's take a look at life in 1913, wherever this guy named Sver Braten is from, knowing that that name is very familiar to me because I grew up in a little farming community in North Dakota. And I flip open the page, I'm like, holy moly, there's a picture of my hometown in 1913. What? This is crazy. And then I flip more pages and I see that there's Sver Braten with his future bride standing in front of my family's grave marker at the cemetery. Wow. And his passion is this thing called circus. Well, I got to know more about this circus because I feel like I know this guy. So I started diving in. And when I started diving in, I ran into photos like the first one on your screen there. This is an image of the Willenda family. When I say Willendas, do you guys know? Does that ring a bell with anyone? Famous circus family? Yeah, okay.
Willendas.
Kind of sounds a little familiar. Yes, yes, good. Willendas, someone right? Died, they flew, okay. I'm seeing good responses here. Let me tell you a little bit about the Willendas. They were a wire walking family, as you can see in the photo. This was taken in their backyard. So you can imagine what backyards look like for circus people. In Sarasota, there is a, Marianne, we're gonna get to that. There's a marker. If you go to Sarasota, Florida, you can follow historical markers throughout the town and see where the great Willendas had their house in their backyard, practice yard. And they had this set up in the backyard. And you can see the picture, the girl, little girl in the front is Carla. Carla Willenda just passed away less than a month ago. And her mother, Helen, is right behind her. Her father, Carl, and Philip Kreese is the young boy on the shoulders, I believe. And another Herman Willenda is on the board there at the end. Of course, when I first came to Special Collections in 2008, I had no idea who any of those people were. I just thought, wow, that's kind of weird having a wire in your backyard, but you know, what do I know? So I started putting all the photos together by axe. Now that donor that was from my hometown, Sver Braten, he took this picture. And if you Google the phrase passion for circus, and I encourage you to do that, you'll come across over 10,000 Kodachrome slides of circus people that he took, Sver Braten took. It's an online exhibit that Illinois State University hosts in Passion for Circus, and it's everything, every act. When Kodachrome was king, we also have black and whites there. I can't promise you that this photo is online, but it does, yes, thank you for putting that up, Leslie. It does come from our collection as well. Again, when I was new, I had a young man come to Special Collections, and the coach of our circus, I don't know if you all know, Illinois State University has the longest running collegiate circus in the United States, if not the world. And the name of that circus is Gamma Phi Circus. And the coach of that circus and I are good friends, as you would expect that to be, right? He knew circus, I didn't know a thing about circus. So I called him up and I said, you know, what's going on? And he said, I'm sending a student to you. His name is Sam. And just do what you can with Sam. He's new, he's a first year student. He doesn't know any much about being at a university, but we want him to succeed here. So Sam found his way to me. And Sam was a very slight person. Very diminutive, very slender, very refined looking. Just a really beautiful young man, very shy. And I spent an afternoon with Sam, and I wish I could remember his last name. I do not. But he was the first circus performer I met. He was a third generation wire walker family. And I had seen that picture that I just was on the screen, and I was like, oh, the Walendas. Do you know the Walendas? And he's like, oh, we all want to be the Walendas. You know, they're seven generations strong now, he said to me in 2008. And I'm only third generation, and I would, you know, do anything to meet even a Walenda. And I thought, well, golly, I have something that he might like. And I ran and I got the shoes that you see on the screen before you now. Those are the shoes that Carla Walenda wore when she walked the wire the first time. She was 3 years old, and her mother was serving her father coffee at the breakfast table and happened to look up out the window and saw their only child, Carla, in those shoes, walking the practice wire, using a broomstick as a balance pole. She starts flipping out. Carl, we have to do something. That's our only child. What's going to happen? You know? And he said, no, we have to let her finish. I can't imagine the fear that mother must have had. They let her finish. And of course, you know, Carla just passed away, as I mentioned earlier, about a month ago now. So I got these shoes and I put them into Sam's hands. I made sure his hands were, you know, cleanly washed, and so the oils wouldn't transfer to the shoes. And Sam started crying. How do you put words to that? You're bringing someone, in a way, their history, and changing their life by interacting with an artifact. I think that's just really a tremendous thing. And that's one of the things that I love about my job, is meeting people like Sam and showing them things like that changed your life. Now, how do I know that Helen looked up outside of the dining room window and saw her only child? We know that because we have a whole box, actually 6 inches of letters between Helen and Carl Walenda and the guy named Sverre Bratton, the guy from my hometown. He kept carbon copies. Those are just copies of the letters that he wrote, along with all the letters he got in response. And I'm gonna switch tacks a little bit and say, you guys ever have a really bad day? Like, really bad day where you just, you can't deal with it anymore
today?
Yeah, well, I had one of those days. It was now, I'm going to say about 8 years ago. And there's two of us that work in special collections, okay? There's just two of us. And when one of us has a really bad day, there's not much, it's a closed unit. It's the most secure location on campus. It takes one key to get in. It takes a separate key to get out. Your space is limited. So where are you going to go when you have a really bad day? I went to the vault and I went to those boxes, those 42 boxes of letters. And I was just grumpy, you know, black cloud was over my head. And I just yanked. I pulled one of the boxes from the shelves and I sat down on the linoleum with my skirt all around me. And I just opened the box and I thought, you know, I'm going to read a really thick file and I'm going to learn something about circus because I need to learn about this stuff. And I pulled the Lewisita Lears file. You can see her letterhead here, along with photos of her. Wasn't she gorgeous? My God. So I'm having a bad day. I start at the beginning and I realize I'm reading letters from a girl. She's a teenager. English is not her first language. She's German. She aspires to be a center ring star. Now, back when she was writing this letter in the late teens and early 1920s, center ring star was the equivalent of making it on Broadway or being a big movie star, because stars in the center ring were equivalent to movie stars of the day. So that was her goal. She had a stepfather who was in circus and her mother was also in circus, and they were training her to do incredible things with her body. They wanted her to be a strong woman and a single trapeze performer. Well, if you go to the next slide, we get an idea of what her act looks like. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, imagine yourself going to a circus, looking in the spotlight over one of the rings, she wasn't yet in center ring, and seeing this woman do a neck hang with her arms out like that, her legs splayed like that, rocking back and forth on her trapeze bar, no net. Yeah, the strength of her neck was that incredible. But in her letters, she writes that she could look down at the audience and see that they were yawning. And she realizes, she writes her friends, you know, if I could make them love me a little bit, I bet I could get center ring. So she works on her showmanship skills, how to present herself, how to carry herself, how to be a star. And eventually she makes it to the center ring. Fantastic, right? I would love to see this woman's act. It would scare me spitless, but I would love to see her progression also from a third ring or a first ring star into a center ring star. I think it must have been magnificent. When you are a center ring star, as she was, you are assured year-long employment. So you would work in the greatest show on earth, the Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Circus, from April to October, and then you could tour the rest of the world where they had circuses indoors, not under canvas, from October to April. Well, that was her plan. You could make really good money doing that, but you're risking your life, right? Well, the year is now 1938. What happens in 1938 in Germany? It's not good, right? Hitler's looking at Poland thinking it looks pretty tasty. Hitler indeed decrees that if you are a German-born citizen, you will serve only the fatherland. And again, we know this because I'm reading it in her letters that are coming to us in 1938 and 39 and 40. And the war is getting initially, but she was like, you know, I understand that there's a war, but it's just a misunderstanding. This Hitler guy, he's putting a lot of us Germans to work. Our economy is really booming. It's, you know, these things that you're hearing are just, you know, it's just, it's not true. It's not that bad. The letters continue. And I'm now in the middle of the vault going, oh no, no, Luisita, no. But I got to keep reading. It's now like 6 o'clock. Everyone's gone home, right? But I'm still in the vault reading. I have to. And the war gets worse. She counts as her most prized possession during the war, her typewriter. Here's like a rock star before there were rock stars, and she wants her typewriter. But she explains to her friends that that is her lifeline to the rest of the world. So she goes to her house in Berlin, which has been bombed twice, and she sneaks her typewriter back with her. And she continues writing letters. Well, now it's like, I don't know, 7:30, and I'm getting kind of hungry, but I can't leave. I've got to find out what happens to Luisita Lears, but the folder ends. What? Forget the bad day. I mean, this girl is living a bad life in Germany, right? I know. No, it can't be. So I close the folder. I open the box. I put the folder back, and I see 1945-. I'm like, oh, she's still alive. She made it through the war. Well, now I'm in it, right? I got to find out what happens. What happens is that she survives the war. Her parents survived the war. And she details for me and for anyone else who would like to read these letters, the fact that the German government, of course, Hitler's gone, allots something minimal like 75 grams of protein to a family per week to live on. And she writes a letter that will be in my heart always. She writes a letter which says, dear friends, I used to be a strong woman. I used to be a proud woman, but I am no more. I'm writing you begging for food. I have no shoes. Do you have an old dress you can spare? My mother doesn't have a dress. Send any help you can. What? Okay. So bad days gone, right? I learned more about the war from this lady's letters than I ever did in school. It's the primary source material that is just the stuff of legend. You know, we as Americans always learn the glory. We came in with our P-51s, our bombers, we saved the world from tyranny, and we should celebrate that, absolutely. But we don't often hear the other side of the war. And it's because of Louis C. DeLeers that we know that. Similarly, other letters in those collections of 42 boxes, we've got circus stars witnessing the first shots fired in the Spanish Revolution in 1936. Circus stars were all over the world and writing about what they were seeing, what they were experiencing. And that's an amazing thing. That's an amazing thing.
I think I heard about some tattoo history being related to P.T. Barnum. And, you know, how the outcasts went to the circus. It's just interesting.
Well, that's a topic we get to a lot in the classes that we host in Special Collections. And I'll get to that in a minute. But let me finish this out. So other things we have over a million things in our collection. And I loved hearing about Merle Evans. We don't have a Merle Evans collection, but he wrote Sverre Bratton. Sverre started his career as a musician on the USS Kearsarge, and of course he wrote Merle Evans a lot of letters, and those are in our collection. We also have posters, over 13,000 posters-ish, and this one was from 1938. I chose it obviously because that was the year Lucita got stuck, but you can see the Willendas were on the wire there in Winter Garden, which was a fabulous venue in Berlin that was bombed into near oblivion, I believe. Eunice is also on the bill. He could stand on one finger. He's doing that on top of the globe on the left-hand side of the screen there. And in fact, we have a poster where the Willendas were doing a private viewing for Hitler, which is really rather disturbing. But that's a different story for another day. And then we have artifacts. We have wardrobe. We have over 1,000 pieces of wardrobe, and we have artifacts like what you're going to see next. Carl Willenda. I got to bring it back to Carl. Carl Willenda met his fate. And I know some of you said the Flying Willendas. The Flying Willendas, that name came after 1961, where they were walking the wire and several people died. One person was injured for the rest of his life. He's made a paraplegic, Mario, in Detroit in 1961. And it was the press that called them the Flying Willendas after that. So the Willenda family is not too proud about the flying part, but they were the Great Willendas. They prefer the Great Willendas. Carl Willenda kept walking from his 33 minute standing ovation in 1931 in Madison Square Garden, all the way up to the late 1970s when he was walking in, I believe, Puerto Rico, and severe winds toppled him off his wire and he fell to his death. So this is sections of his balance pole that came to us after he did fall to his death. People come from all over the world to do research in Special Collections. We're delighted that they do. We've had hosted people from Japan, Russia, China, Australia, you know, most of Europe, Mexico. And it's always our delight to do so. And it was my great thrill when Nick Willenda came to visit us after his Grand Canyon walk, and he wanted to learn more about his great-grandfather, Carl. And he offered me many $1,000s for what you're seeing in front of you. And of course, he could not have it. We are not in the business of having our treasures leave us, even when greats like Nick Willenda ask for them. Why do we have this collection? That's a question I get a lot. Bloomington Normal, I'm speaking to you from the former trapeze capital of the world. And when you think of the caste system, if you will, of circus performers, you have the clowns. They're not bottom rung by any stretch of the imagination, but then you have band, and then you have wire walkers, but at the top, literally, you have the aerialists. And that's what this town produced more of than any other place on the planet. From the 1870s, when it was rather new, Jules Leotard invented this thing called trapeze. Yes, Leotard comes from him, Jules Leotard. And it crossed the pond. He invented it in France, invented it. It was a trap. The trapeze was a physical fitness apparatus before it became a circus apparatus. He's Jules Leotard is the guy who made it a circus apparatus. It came to the States by 1871. This town had a gym where a new thing called trapeze was installed. Boys took to it like boys sometimes do, and they joined a circus, which was, you know, arguably the golden age of circuses during that time period. And it just kept happening. I've written a book about the golden age of circus and trapeze. I'm writing another book about our most famous alum, Arthur Marshall Vasconcelos, who dropped out of school in ninth grade to become a trapeze flyer and ended his career as executive vice president of Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Circus, where he worked for John Ringling North and his brother, Henry Ringling North, who were nephews of John Ringling and owned the circus from 1938 till the 1960s when they sold it to the Feld Corporation. And they ran it until 2017 when it closed, sadly. Somebody asked a question. Oh my gosh, there's lots of chats. Did Leo Sieta go back to the circus? Oh, wow, okay. Can I start there? That's a fantastic question. Okay, so we know the rest of the story. The rest of the story, this is so good. Okay, yes, she wanted to. She desperately wanted to. I've met a lot of really amazing circus performers, and it's like an infection, but a good one. Once you perform, you always want to perform, and they've got charisma coming out of every pore. Yes, she wanted to get back into it. She wrote a letter to John Ringling North at the time, saying, you know, let me audition for you when you come back to Europe to audition for new talent. Let me audition for you. And he was like, yeah, of course, I'll let you. Yeah, you are a center ring star. I'm going to do that. But when he saw her, she had been malnourished for far too long. Her body couldn't do that incredible act. She could never regain the muscles that she once had, which is very, very sad. But circus performers are insatiable. They've got such a creative juice flowing through them. She became a sculptress, and she sculpted. She sold some of her sculptures. She lived in Germany. She did not die until 1996. And I'm just waiting for someone to do that research on her, because I think her life would make an incredible movie. She didn't die till 1996. Did she have kids? I don't know. Their records are in German and I don't speak it. So maybe someone can find out. Let's see what else we have.
Yeah, anybody who has questions, type them into the chat, unmute yourself. I have a question. thank you so much, Maureen.
Yeah.
It's been wonderful. The researchers that you get, is it a mix of practitioners, people who are performing, and people who are scholars or historians?
All of the above. Full disclosure, I am a member of the Circus Historical Society. I'm proud to say I was the second female board member. Yay! So we get a lot of circus historians coming our way, and there really is this thing called Circus Historical Society, and it's wonderful, as well as the Circus Fans Association that also exists. And the Circus Windjammers is the circus band passion group. And and each of these has a publication. Circus Fanfare is the circus band magazine. Bandwagon is the name of our Circus Historical Society's publication. I've lost where I'm going. Yeah. Oh, yes. So lots of different people come to do all sorts of research. And I've noticed during the last year of pandemic, ooh, that we are getting a lot more circus researchers. And I don't really know how to attribute that, except that people are at home. They're doing more genealogy, perhaps, because we're getting a fair bit of that. You know, the story, there's a story that my great aunt was a circus performer. Can you verify that? Well, I need a little bit more information before I can verify that. There are lots of students. So when I first took over Special Collections, I taught one class, a total of 22 students my first year in 2008. And pre-pandemic, the year before we shut down in March of last year for the pandemic, we were teaching 1,400 kids in almost every subject, from accounting, because we have cash books and ledgers from the Ringling Brothers Circus and the Barnum and Bailey Circus and the Ringling Brothers Barnum and Bailey Circus, because of course, Ringling bought Barnum and Bailey in 1907, but didn't join them until 1919. And oh yeah, by the way, we have that letter. Woohoo! We have that letter where Otto Ringling's writing to his four brothers saying, hey guys, I think we ought to buy this thing called Barnum and Bailey. It'd be one hell of a big show. Yeah, nowhere else has that. It's here, it's in our shop. So accounting, art, business, insurance, theater, because they're looking at our wardrobe collection, you name it, circus. I mean, it's really hard for me to come up with a department that you can't tie into circus. Certainly technology, acting, presentation, I mean, the list goes on and on. It's a whole lot of fun. You never get bored in this job, ever.
I love it. We have time for just one or two more questions. Allison asks, what is your favorite item that you have in the collection? Is there anything that you would love to acquire?
Yeah, oh boy. Okay, so I told you guys I'm writing a book on Art Cancello, and I know because I have five of them, I know he kept a daily diary, and I have five of them, from two from the 60s, one from the 70s, and two from the 1980s. So I would love to get the rest of his diaries, because he was a very multifaceted guy with a ninth grade education. He pretty much ruled the entertainment world for several decades. Didn't always get along with John Ringling North, but loved Merle Slees Evans. His middle name was Slees, and I've never figured out why. S-L-E-A-S-E. Must be a family name.
Jay asks, how do you get materials? Did you contact Ringling Brothers Circus when they closed?
Oh, Ringling Brothers has their own the repository of materials. So I did contact them and asked if they wanted to have, you know, any documentation of the last performance in my collection. I think they were mostly interested in helping themselves. I'm not saying anything bad about them. And Guy Liliberté is a very interesting guy from Cirque du Soleil. But primarily, when people in the profession, in the business of circus, or the circus historians are looking for where they want the material to reside, they can go to a museum. Circus World Museum and the Ringling Museum are two of the largest, or they can come to an educational institution like Illinois State University, where we work very hard to integrate the materials into the curriculum. And in that way, circus lives on. I had no circus background. And if I could give you guys just one piece of advice for special collections librarianship, is learn your collection. Don't be afraid to go to those who know your collection better than you, and learn everything you can about it, and be passionate about it. There are a lot of people out there who think circus is kind of sketchy. I'm not one of them, obviously. I think there's something to be learned for it. And if you're not passionate about what your collection is, you're not going to like your job. And what good is that, right?
And you might discover something in the folders, like Lucita's story, which is phenomenal.
Yeah, it gives me goosebumps every time.
Okay, we have time for just one quick last question. Robin says, thank you for sharing your stories with us. I have a number of friends who work or have worked for Feld and Cirque du Soleil. They're still on pause due to the pandemic. Does your collection feature anything that has to do with the technical side of circus, such as rigging, lights, etc.?
I'm not going to do it. Because I'm writing this book about Art Cancello, and he started his career as a trapeze performer. Yes, I have a lot of books on rigging and the technical side of circus. Lighting was a big deal, of course, the lime for the lighting, the props, the, I'm not going to do it, but if I were to turn my camera around and you would see my bulletin board in front of me, you would see what rigging looked like in the 1920s. If you saw that movie, what was that movie? Because we get asked a lot by movies and documentaries. Was it Jumbo? Yes, it was Jumbo. There's a flying rig in that movie. They contacted us to get the dimensions for that flying rig, and it's now up on my wall. So I have a good sense of that. And you can learn so much about this stuff. Rigging is Dumbo. Was it Dumbo? I always got Dumbo and Jumbo mixed up.
Amazing. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Maureen.
Thank you.
Wonderful stories. So informative. Thank you for joining us. It's been fantastic. We're going to go to our last presenter of the evening.
You guys can visit anytime, by the way.
As soon as I can fly, yes.
Yay, yeah.
I would love it. So thank you guys. We have one more presenter. Also, before you leave us tonight, we'll be posting a really quick survey in the chat box. If you would like to take that, it would be wonderful. Our final speaker of the evening, please welcome Jet Jacobs. She's head of public services, outreach, and community engagement for UCLA Library Special Collections.
Hi, everybody. Give me just a second to share my screen and set all of this up. All right. There we go. Okay. I'm Jet Jacobs. I work in UCLA Library Special Collections. I'll get into a bit of kind of the specifics of my job in just a second. But I just want to say I'm really grateful for the other presenters because they talked more specifically about their performing arts collections and their circus related collections. And in a perfect world, I would be back at work and the pandemic would be, you know, in our past. But as it is currently, UCLA has been essentially closed for over a year and we haven't had access to our physical collections. So when I agreed to speak with y'all tonight, I was really hoping that we'd be done with this by now and I'd be back in my collections. And that is not the case. So I'm working primarily with our digital assets, which is actually fine because it gave me a really great opportunity to look at the materials that we had already previously digitized. And made available and what sort of circus related collections are available there. And I'm also gonna talk a little bit sort of more about how we teach with our collections and how we engage our users with our collections. And then I'll talk a little bit about, I'll go to the next slide. I'm gonna talk a little bit about like how I got to the job that I have currently provide maybe some helpful tools and resources for y'all because I'm imagining some of you will be on the job search soon. I'll talk a little bit about some things that we've done in order to pivot to pandemic pedagogy. And then I'm going to talk about a tool that we like to use in order to incorporate durable digital research outputs in some of the classes that we've worked with in the past. So a little bit about UCLA Library Special Collections. I have to admit that my previous job was in a much smaller institution. And so UCLA, when I got here, is like huge. Just massive. It's like one of the largest libraries, our largest academic libraries in the nation. And our special collections is internationally recognized. And that is a lot of pressure because those are a lot of collections to get familiar with in a really short amount of time. And a lot of users who really expect somebody in my position to be sort of like the conduit to access all of those materials. So there's a lot of pressure, but it's also really exciting because I get to access a lot of materials that in my previous jobs, I've been like, well, wouldn't it be great if we had these materials because faculty are asking me for this? And wouldn't it be great if we could engage our community with these types of things? But we really lacked the collections and the connections in order to do that. So UCLA Library Special Collections is, like many special collections, a grouping of previously distinct special collections across the university. I think this is really common, especially in a lot of academic libraries. It's Research Library Special Collections, University Archives, Performing Arts, the Center for Oral History, and the Special Collections for Medicine and the History of the Sciences. So it's a lot of disciplines under that big umbrella. And some of our kind of most notorious, well-known collections are, we have the Sadler Collection of 19th Century British Fiction, which is one of my favorites. And if y'all ever have a chance to visit UCLA's campus, and we are open to the public, I highly recommend coming in for a tour of the booth room, which is this gorgeous mid-century modern wood-paneled library has the entire Sadler collection, which is a collection of primarily intact first edition publisher bindings. A lot of them are triple deckers, and it's one of those moments where you like walk in and you feel like Belle in Beauty and the Beast, and she does that moment with the library and she's like, "This is all mine," and that's exactly what walking into the booth room is like. We also have the Han Yu Shan collection, which is a collection of primarily examination papers and a lot of early printings. And one of the coolest things in that collection is a complete set of the woodblocks, the xylographic woodblocks that were used to print the Diamond Sutra, which we've used in a lot of printing. We also have the largest collection of Middle Eastern manuscripts at any public institution in North America. So that's Islamic, Armenian, Persian, Turkish, and Urdu manuscripts, which we're hoping to use a lot more in the future, because we've built a lot of contacts at the university to try to engage with those a little bit more. We have a really impressive and exciting collection of medieval manuscripts as well, from longtime donors, the Rouses. And then we have the Amundsen Murphy Aldine Collection, which is the largest collection of Aldine imprints in North America as well. So a lot of really fun stuff, but the images that I'm using today in this presentation come from the Los Angeles Daily News Negatives collection. And so I've included a link here both to the digitized images from that collection, as well as the finding aid. And I'll be including a link to this presentation as well. So if anyone wants to kind of go back through and mine this collection or explore anything, you can definitely do that. I just want to say that, like, this is an elephant, like, just taking a bath in Venice Beach, which I'm not sure I would go into the Venice Beach ocean, but, like, I love the fact that that's a really good solution for washing an elephant when you're playing a circus on the coast. So the LA Times Photographic Archive is essentially over a century of Los Angeles visual history. It contains over 4 million images, although we've primarily only digitized the nitrate negatives and the glass negatives. It includes photo negatives and prints, glass negatives, really like if it was a photographic medium in the early 20th century, like we have it. And it is, I have to say, like one of our most commonly requested and most commonly licensed collections in UCLA Library Special Collections. And I mention that because I've been in the field for about 20 years, and one of the most shocking things that I've had to deal with is the expectation that in almost every job that I've had, I've expected to be somewhat proficient in copyright as it applies to licensing and intellectual property. And I feel like maybe sometimes when we're in library school, we take some classes on copyright as it pertains to sort of like assisting researchers in the reference process. But for many of us in special collections, we're gonna wind up being asked questions about rights for collections that came in before those were really considerations that any of our curators or archivists were really thinking about. And then trying to apply those understandings of copyright to new formats and new arenas, like, you know, someone who gave us their collection in 1960 did not anticipate that we would ever have the means to scan them and put them on the internet. So there's a lot of rights issues involved in that. And also, we regularly license materials from these collections and other collections as well to documentarians and film studies, film researchers, companies. We've licensed LA Times images to Levi's and Nike. So there are moments when somebody says like, "Hey, how much should we charge so-and-so for this image?" And it really just, you're kind of just you just have to make a judgment call, I guess. So that was one of the things that I was shocked most when I got into the field was sort of, you know, we're supposed to be sort of the expert of many things, but I did not realize that copyright and intellectual property law would be one of them. So one of the other collections that I'm really excited about that we have at UCLA is the LSE Punk Archive. And I think the coolest thing about this is we have a number of curators in our curatorial unit, and those are individuals who are selectors that work with community members to spend out budgets to acquire materials that support our collection priorities. But the Punk Archive is collaboratively curated, and the group is a number of library staff and other sort of interested people. So it provides a really interesting perspective sort of on collecting and on community outreach. And it's also given us a really great opportunity to do more community engagement with different groups because the punk collection is so exciting and because there's so many people who are interested in, you know, documenting the LA punk scene that are still alive and that still want to have that conversation and that still want to be really involved. And so this has been really exciting. So some of the collections that we have are almost complete runs of both Slash and Maximum Rock and Roll. We have the archive and the papers of the American Hotel and Al's Bar. And then we have the collection of a number of individuals who were really integral in the punk scene in Los Angeles. And we're really hoping to grow the stories of LA punk, like beyond the what my colleagues would call the pale male, which is like the LA punk scene is inherently diverse, and it inherently tells the stories of groups who have been historically marginalized, and like punk is the medium through which they resist. So we're really hoping to create conversations and relationships with the individuals so that the relationship isn't so much the historically extractive relationship that has been sort of you know, the status quo in library special collections, but really more to create a relationship and figure out how we can support these communities while also stewarding and making available their stories for research and instruction. So a little bit about LSC. Well, I'm gonna... Something about talking for like 10 minutes straight makes you really thirsty. So I mentioned Library Special Collections is a really large department. And so because of that, we're organized into three functional units, curators and collections, collections management, and then my unit. And the long and short of it is basically the curators and collections get the stuff, collections management describes the stuff, and then I make sure that it's accessible and it's served up in multiple areas. So PISOs, which, my boss occasionally sometimes jokingly calls Pozole because she can never remember how it's pronounced, is public services, outreach, and community engagement. So this really encompasses a lot, but essentially it means like trying to make sure that all of these collections that we steward are accessible to as many community members as possible. UCLA is a public institution. It's one of the things that I like most about working at a public academic library is that there's really like no one that we would want to discourage from using our collections. That means we want to encourage everyone to come use our collections. I come from a background in public services. So this is really kind of like baked into my philosophy. So as opposed to this lovely lion tamer who is told to keep out of the tiger cage, I want everyone to come into the tiger cage always as much as humanly possible. And so in practice, this means that I oversee the following areas, which is kind of a lot, but I feel like most of us in academic libraries kind of wear a lot of different hats. And then whenever I talk to students who are in MLS programs, I wanna make sure that I like focus on the job process. It is so opaque and I wanna increase the transparency in this. So the link at the bottom of the slide is the link to this presentation, but it's in a parent folder that also includes the JD CV cover letter presentation and itinerary for the job that I currently have. So if you are interested in seeing sort of what the complete package looks like as you're preparing your job application materials, please feel free to use these and reach out to me if you have any questions. I share these because the job that I have currently, I mean, I mentioned before I wear a lot of hats. The job description itself was like 3 pages long. And so my cover letter is like 3 pages long. And so when people say something like your cover letter should fit on one page, I'm like, that is not advice that should be consistently applied to everyone. You have to write a cover letter that applies to the job that you're going for. So you can sort of see how you might respond to a job description that's basically like, you know, you wear seven different hats and you do it all the time. So then I also want to share about sort of my history, my career trajectory. I mentioned I've been working in libraries for 20 years. That's because I literally got a job in a library after high school. And we talk a lot about, or the field talks a lot about eliminating vocational awe. And I think that's very important. I think a lot of us talk about being called to librarianship and it's really fulfilling and we enjoy our jobs, which is true. But also I work in a library because it pays the bills. It has job security. And when I was in high school or just graduating high school, they're like, hey, would you like a full-time job where you have health insurance and a salary? I was like, please sign me up. And then as I worked in a library, I realized that it was a sort of job that I could effectively work and I would enjoy it. And it didn't seem inherently competitive. Although now that I'm in middle management, I would amend that understanding a little bit that it is somewhat competitive. And also, you know, it's a job where I feel like I don't sell anything during the day. Like, of course, my understanding of neo-capitalism is that all institutions inherently support capitalism. But I do like the fact that I am not selling a product every day. And I feel like at the very basic level, I'm supporting a learning institution. I work in an institution of learning and I find that really fulfilling. So I worked in a library while I did my undergrad. I took a year off of maternity leave. I always joke about how I had my BA like 2 months before I had my BA BY. That's a funny joke in my family. and then I went to grad school in a hybrid situation for 2 years. And then it took me 3 years to get a job out of grad school. And I say that just, you know, to normalize the fact that a lot of us don't get jobs out of grad school, and that is okay. It feels crappy as it's happening, but it's pretty normal. And also, I graduated like right after the stock market crash of 2008. So like, there weren't a lot of jobs going around. So then my first job was in Texas. I worked there for 6 years. And I had a pretty mid-range salary for Texas. And now I'm in a middle management position in LA. And I share my salary again to normalize the transparency in the field. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to ask. One of the things about UCLA is that we have a review process that is essentially conflated with our tenure and promotion process. So I benefited from that in that I had a starting salary of nearly 70. And after 18 months, I went up for review and I got exceptional performance, which is the way that they can bump you up, additional merit increases. And so that's how I essentially made a $20,000 raise, which is still not a lot of money in LA, but man, I'll tell you, my dad is super proud of me because that's more than he ever made in his whole life. The 90s were weird, right? So I'm going to talk a little bit about instruction. And I just want to say that one of the things that I'm really, really lucky for is I've been at UCLA since 2018. In the very beginning, I told everyone that my goal was going to be expand the instruction program because I do believe that one of the most important things that we do in an academic library and special collections is support instruction, and everything else is secondary. Yes, research is important, but it is through instruction that we encourage future scholars and we encourage future research in our materials. So one of the things that I'm most proud of is I did that and everyone was so impressed that they then cleared me to hire a teaching and learning librarian, basically someone else to offload the instruction. And I justified that by basically saying that we teach about 100 classes a year in special collections, and I was teaching half of them. So all of those other things in my portfolio were sort of taking a backseat to the instruction, which again, I feel really strongly that that is an important part of my job. But apparently other people expect me to do other things. And so in order to do that, we hired a full-time teaching librarian and he started in the summer, which means he started during remote work and he has not worked in the physical office. So he had essentially a remote orientation and then he will have another orientation once we return to on-campus teaching. But he has done a really, really great job, especially given the fact that we're doing completely remote instruction with a number of faculty who, in all honesty, like really had zero experience teaching in a remote setting prior to pandemic. If you'd like to reach out to Jimmy, his information is online, or you can go through me. That's totally fine. He's a great person to talk to with questions about instruction. Our instruction program is really focused on providing future and current scholars with general primary source literacy. Because we are currently teaching in a remote setting, we've had to really rely on our digital repositories. But because our current repository at UCLA is limited, it's actually been an opportunity to include other digital repositories in our instruction, which is quite beneficial. Because sometimes you'll work with a faculty member and they are looking for specific examples of something to share with their class. And it's something that you're not really strong in, but they're coming in for a physical appointment where you're laying out materials. And it can be somewhat awkward to say, but also there's this other institution that has this great online repository. And so this has given us an opportunity to really do that in these classes and get the faculty that we're working with interested in using, national and international collections that really complement their learning outcomes. We really focus on hands-on collaborative learning activities. We try to port that over to the remote learning environment. Although when it's in person, it's a lot of hands-on with the materials. We've really scaled back the sort of show and tell aspect of instruction where you have like an expert sort of like explaining or walking you through the collection. We really just sort of like to get the students to dive in with the materials, find something that interests them, and then start a conversation. We encourage a critical lens because it's really important for students to understand that they can't really take primary source materials at face value, just as they shouldn't take any secondary materials at face value. And we really want students to start thinking about, you know, how did materials come to be in special collections? Whose voices are being represented? Whose voices are being silenced? How can these students in their current work and in their future navigate the issues of sort of representation in our collections and interrogate that? And then we do a lot of think, pair, share, which I think can be cliche at some point, but it really is important for us, especially when it comes to the process of active learning, to get students to really like share with their peers, not just to feel the stress of reporting out to individuals who I'm assuming they assume know more about the collections than they do. And I really want to break that down and get students to really question that they bring a lot to these materials and these interactions. So I mentioned that we are really limited in what we have available digitally, and that's because we're currently transferring our digital library to a Samvera instance, and we're still migrating a lot of our digital assets. It is stressful, and it would have been great if it would have been done before we migrated to a remote learning environment, but that's just not how the world works. And we also really don't have a place for student digital work to be hosted, which is something that I struggle with a lot because it's something that faculty more and more are requesting. They want students to create digital exhibits. They want students to create durable digital research projects. And so we've really been struggling with like solutions for that. And also it's really hard to teach materiality while you're remote. One of the things that I teach a lot is book history. I teach about format and print history. And it's really important when we do that, that students have the opportunity to like actually feel materials and see the scale and the size of things and touch parchment and touch printed paper and hold a cuneiform tablet in their hand. And it's really hard to do that while remote. So we've dealt with that and the challenge of how exhausting it is to be on Zoom and to be talked at for an extended period of time. And we've pivoted a lot to this sort of flipped classroom model where we do a lot of videos of the lecture portion. And then the classroom visit itself is really just an activity. And we ask students to come to the class with questions that they might've had while they were watching the videos. And then it's more of a conversation than it is a sort of like one-sided lecture with response. And then I'm not going to read through all of these. Again, Zoom is exhausting and I don't want to read things to you. But I just added some of the questions of the activities that we have students go through, both in person and also we try to replicate this in a remote setting. And again, this is the first part of a hands-on with archives activity where we ask students to look at the finding aid and try to identify, you know, how this might be useful for the research in the future. And also to sort of ask questions about, again, whose voice is being represented and how this description might have either highlighted or silenced the individuals whose stories are contained therein. Because again, it's really important that individuals understand that finding aid is sort of the first secondary source that is often created by an archival collection, and therefore it is inherent bias, and it is worthy of interrogating. And then again, I mentioned, we just like students to get like hands-on with material, just like jump in, pull a folder out. We of course talk about handling before we start pulling out folders and best practices. But I really want them to just like pull something out that speaks to them, and then go through the next part of the activity, which is basically to kind of look at it through a critical lens, and talk about like who its intended audience is, because really the question about materiality, especially with special collections, is not so much about the object itself, but sort of how the object was used and created, like what the audience, what its intended audience was originally for, and then potentially like what its inevitable use was. And I find that really interesting, and a lot of the students do as well, because it helps them to understand that like information is not a neutral, information itself is not neutral, and then the information containers themselves are not neutral as well. And then we ask them to go a little bit further and talk about maybe questions that aren't answered to sort of facilitate any sort of further secondary research that they might want to conduct. And then we have a sort of somewhat separate activity for when we are dealing with rare books. And that's only because sometimes the learning outcome of, you know, instructors who really want their students to use primarily archival materials is somewhat different than the instructors who really want students to use printed monographs or manuscripts, like and codices. And so oftentimes this comes with an introductory lecture on, you know, format and printing history, whether it's how manuscripts are made or how books are printed in various regions. We really try to push a global book history perspective, especially because our collections represent global book history and we can put them in conversation with one another. But again, we really like to have them apply what they've learned in this lecture. You know, what is a format? What is a, you know, what does it look like in the print shop? How are mistakes made? What is paper and why is it important? And these types of things. And then sort of go through these answers and interrogate their object and try to figure out, you know, who the intended audience was, maybe what a publisher was, how was publishing different in the 1600s versus how we view it now, and these types of questions. And then, you know, again, interrogating the material to see like the physicality of it, like what are illustrations, what function do illustrations serve? You know, looking at your object, how do you think it was intended to be used? Like, is it a pocketbook? Is it a folio that's supposed to be in a lectern, et cetera, et cetera. And then again, we try to leave a bunch of time at the end of the class for everyone to share out. A lot of times we do this in a group setting, especially in remote learning, because it's really isolating to be in a classroom on Zoom. And so it's a lot of times it makes it easier if you have like a small group of students and you're like having a conversation together, and then we come back and ask a representative from that group to sort of report out about something that they found really interesting. So then I'm gonna just share really quickly about Timeline.js, which is a tool that I've used in the past and I highly recommend. It is from the Knight Labs, and they have a few open source tools that are related to Timeline.js that can tell stories in a different way. But I tend to use Timeline.js because a lot of what we're working with students has to do with information chronologically. So one of the cool things about Timeline.js is that it is a tool that helps learn primary source literacy, curation and deductive writing, active learning, visual literacy, data literacy, and citation, kind of like all within one like large learning outcome. It requires a lot of scaffolding, and it is definitely not something that you kind of want to wedge into a class that already has like a full docket. This is a thing that I work with faculty a lot on, which is to clarify how many learning outcomes are in a class, because a lot of times they'll come to me and they'll say, I want the students to learn this, 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 this. Also, I want them to create a digital exhibit. And having a conversation with a faculty member to get them to understand that like curation and writing didactic texts and learning how to input and format a digital exhibit is in its of itself a learning outcome. And that when you're working in a quarter system, 10 weeks is like not a lot of time. So wedging in a completely distinct learning outcome needs to be done thoughtfully and proactively. So I'm going to be like really cliche and literally quote myself in an article that I'm about to publish on Timeline.js, which is why we like this tool so much. And it's because it's an ability for students to take primary sources, but put them into the context of the historical periods that they're studying and look at it chronologically in a way that I think a lot of students don't have the opportunity to, especially again within a 10-week course. So we have applied this in a class, we've applied this in multiple classes, but primarily we've been using it with one of the history faculty members, Dr. McClendon, who teaches a capstone history course. And her focus is generally early modern England. And we have a number of holdings in this area. So we usually partner also with the Clark Library, which has a number of holdings. Actually, the bulk of our early modern English language materials are housed at the Clark. So it's often, they're often embedded as a partner in the class that we teach. So we make sure to scaffold the assignment. So I essentially work for an entire quarter with the instructor prior to the quarter of instruction in order to make sure that all of the visits have been planned out and that the assignment has been scaffolded and we've like really baked in the Timeline.js assignment into the class. And then essentially again, 10 weeks, this is a capstone course. They meet once a week for 3 hours. So for the last two times that we've done this class, essentially three of the library visits or three of the actual classes have been library visits. They do one that's a general intro to research with one of the teaching librarians that we work with, generally the history liaison librarian. We teach an introduction to primary sources and sort of like orientation to primary source literacy. And then we do a hands-on with rare books, very similar to the activity that I talked about just a little bit earlier. And usually we replicate that as the, at the Clark as well, so that they get sort of two orientations to looking at a early modern printed rare book or broadside or manuscript from the time period in order to sort of like identify an item that they would then be interested in researching for their class. And the way that we have done this is requires a little bit of explanation, but I've linked out here both to the spreadsheet, which is the back end where students input the metadata of the items that they're describing and hosting in the digital exhibit. And then I've also linked to the finished timeline as well. And we can kind of look at those. So let's see, I'll go to those in just a second. So one of the interesting things about this class is that it's work and play in early modern England, which is like really broad. And one of the things that we did is we baked in sort of an understanding that the students would meet first to define both the parameters of what does early modern mean as it applies to their class, and then establish a list of canonical events that they feel are like integral in order to understand like what it is that defines early modern. And so a lot of the students picked, you know, kind of, you know, things you would assume, right? So like the Protestant Reformation, the printing press, the Wars of the Roses, these things that we feel are like synonymous canonical events in early modern England. And then they created a post and they populated the spreadsheet with their canonical event. And that was the first assignment. And then throughout the quarter, as they learn more about primary sources and they engage with primary source literacy, they identified an item in special collections that was related to their original canonical event. And then they populated the timeline with that item. And so essentially what you have is a completed timeline with all of the students' individual canonical events, you know, listed on the timeline that you can see in chronological order, and then each of their individual primary source items listed as well. So it gives this really great opportunity for students to see sort of both like the broad view of how we, you know, interpret what is historically early modern England, but also the physical material publications and like instances of information that occurred within those major canonical events. So this is an example of a student who is really interested in the Protestant Reformation and its impact on England. And then his second item was this essentially like a published attack on the church that was talking about sort of the individual failures of the English clergy at that time. And so they were really related in terms of, you know, like how this larger event then impacted the individual publications and the conversations that we're having at that time. So hold on, before I let you go, let me see if I can show y'all the back end of it, because I feel like it's important to just see sort of the architecture of this. So again, when we talk about students learning or like trying to incorporate like a digital exhibit into a class, it's really hard to identify something that both your institution will host and provide access to or make permanent, but also something that has a really low barrier of entry for students who potentially, you know, don't have expertise in something like WordPress, or honestly, if, you know, the people involved in instruction don't have experience in like WordPress or Emeka, or something that involved. And so this is essentially a spreadsheet where you populate your metadata, and you pick your start date and your end date, or you can pick a specific date and make it like a single, like a discrete event. You add a headline, you can add text, and then it links out to whatever like internet hosted media. So for many students, the initial part of the assignment, they picked a canonical event, and then they kind of picked like a Wikipedia page image, which is totally okay because we're talking about secondary research and potential like tertiary research materials. And then this is where we talk about credits and captioning and citations. And then you can add a few more other things. You can group posts one-on-one, but because the students essentially work in the same spreadsheet, it's this really exciting opportunity for students to do collaborative like peer review, like in person, in real time, because oftentimes what we'll do is we'll schedule a workshop where they have kind of like, we've given them a form with the information, with a, like the metadata that they want to determine and to use to describe their object, but then we have them input it in the spreadsheet in the same event as a sort of like flipped workshop model. So if they have any problems or if somebody accidentally breaks the timeline, which is a thing that occasionally happens, they can sort of help each other figure it out in real time. And then this is the sort of resulting timeline. This is sort of like the digital exhibit as it occurs. And then the easiest way that I have found is just to copy the embedded link that Timeline.js creates, and you embed it in a sort of free Google site. And then you have a timeline where you can go through chronologically all of the events that the students have added and populated to the spreadsheet. And then they have one, you know, complete like student project that they have created for this class that they can continually refer back to. So I know a lot of students who have added this to their CVs and added it to their resumes and used it in potential job interviews because they're like, look, I created this digital exhibit. I conducted this research. I have didactic writing text experience. The previous year that we did this, not for this exhibit, or not for this year, but in 2018, the students that created their timeline exhibit based on everyday life in early modern England won both the Library Special Collections and the Clark Library Research Awards, the undergraduate research awards, because their project was so exciting and everyone was so excited about like this durable digital exhibit. That sort of showed what they learned through through the class and it manifested into this like physical object or digital physical object anyway. So that is pretty much all I have to share with y'all. Citations for the images that I used are on the presentation as well. And then I'm gonna go ahead and I'll copy and paste the link to this folder in the Zoom chat. So y'all have it if you would like it. And I will now stop sharing my screen.
Jet, that was so insightful and so inspiring. Thank you for sharing that with us.
Thank you.
I see a couple questions have come through in the chat, so I will just volley them over to you as soon as I find them. Yes. What system do you use to present the LA Times photo collection online?
Ooh, so currently it's... it's in two places. It's in our old digital library, which is a custom built digital library that I don't even know what the back of it is because like one person built it like in the 90s. And it is crumbling, which is why we're migrating to Samvera. But again, the process is really slow. If you have specific questions, I am really not the person to ask, but I can, if you email me, I can get you in touch with the people in the digital library project at UCLA who could tell you more about it.
And Allison wants to know, are the librarians at UCLA tenured?
That is a really good question. So I call it tenure-ish, which is that we are not tenure track, but we have what I think is like really common at other institutions. And I had this at my last institution as well, which is like kind of like a continuing appointment, which is kind of like librarian version of tenure. I like it honestly, because I could just really tell you that I'm not up to a full tenure track job. Like I just really couldn't, I'm just really not there. Like my focus is not in publication enough to really like put together an actual like tenure application bracket. And I don't think that, oh, how do I put this? I've talked to a lot of librarians who have been at institutions where librarians are tenure track, and it's really hard because you effectively have to spend one day of every week out of the office in order to do the things that you need to do to get tenure. And that's really hard on your colleagues. So I think the expectation is very great. And so what we have at UCLA is essentially we go up for review every 2 years, and the review process is sort of like, hello, please justify that you've done your job, and then we'll give you a merit increase. At the same time, we have something called career status, which is basically you have a specific time period in which to go up for career status and be granted career status, which then comes with a merit increase and a little bit more job security. And then there's a couple related things around that. Like I said, I went up for exceptional performance, which is your supervisor decides that you've knocked it out of the park and says, no, this year you really did awesome. And then rather than getting like 2 bumps in your salary scale, you get like 5 bumps on your salary scale. And it's supposed to be rare, which sucks because we all deserve more money. And then I think the only thing that I would say that is I struggle with about that is our review, because our review system is also conflated with our promotion system, right? Like every time you go up for review, it's basically like a mini tenure packet. Like you have to write a huge essay, you have to update your CV, you have to give a huge document on like, it's called a data summary. It's like literally everything that you've done in the last 2 years. Anyway, you spend about 3 months every 2 years getting ready to go up for review. And there's very little mechanism in order to actually like correct, you know, how do I put this? Because you really want the person who's working for you to go up for review successfully, it's really hard to say, actually, these are the areas in your job that we need you to do a little bit better at. And so sometimes systemic problems, sometimes individual problems then become systemic problems. I'll just leave it at that.
The SLC punk thing that you were mentioning, that's based on a movie, isn't it? I thought that was really cool. And do you guys have a zine library by any chance?
It's not necessarily, actually Powell Library, the general library, has a zine collection that's available to check out. And then we have a number of collections that contain zines. So we have like one of those false collections that's sort of like a zine and punk ephemera collection. And then we have other collections that have full runs of zines. So we have a full run of Ben is Dead, and that's in the Darby Romero, Darby Romeo or Darby Romero collection. And that was a zine that she created in LA since like the 90s. So we have bunches of zines that are just in different places.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, before we wrap up tonight, we have one more feature, but I want to thank all of our incredible speakers for joining us on this evening. Each so unique, each so informative. You have really helped us along our way as students in this profession. I want to thank members of the iSchool community for joining us under the Big Top, and thank you to the Roustabouts and the Executive Committee, the Pony Punks, Cage Hands, Grinders, and Gazoonies. You have made this evening truly a spectacle of wonders. And last, but certainly not least, we are going to see something from one of our own SLA student chapter members. So before we pack up our wagons and roll up the tent, our grand finale, Allison Chase Williams.
Hi guys, I'm Allison. And this is a performance I did as an aerialist a few years ago. Enjoy.
Daisy, we don't have volume.
Amazing, Allison, thank you for sharing that. Thank you again, Jet, Maureen, Christina, Allison, our entire executive committee, the iSchool, and everyone who attended tonight's presentation. There is a survey link in the chat box if you would like to take that. And I will run this evening out with a few more slides. Thank you everybody for joining us tonight.
Leslie, I'll get the slides for you.
Okay.
Leslie?
Yes.
The link that was posted, when you click on it, it says you need permission to use this form.
It's probably because you need an SJSU email or account.
Oh, that's unfortunate.
But I think that can be remedied. Let me take a look.
This was great. This was just a wonderful time.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm gonna play some music from Storyblocks. This is copyright free, and I'll keep it low so people could chat if they need to.
Gabby and Daisy, thank you for running the tech side of stuff. It's wonderful.
Thank you. Good job, you guys.
Yeah, it was really magnificent. I mean, what a wonderful evening. Leslie, Gabby, Daisy, all the presenters. I mean, just a beautiful, beautiful evening. Everything we had hoped for and more. Wonderful questions from the attendees. Extremely informative presentations.
Very much so.
That really got into all the detail that the members really like to hear about. Allison was magnificent.
Absolutely. I've been waiting years to see Allison perform.
Yeah, I mean, what a wonderful performance. That was absolutely
wonderful.
Very, very artistic and just extraordinary.
Beautiful.
It was a fantastic evening.
Somebody said they've always wanted to do it. I don't know if you saw that in the chat box or not.
Yeah,
they were so
lots of places to do it.
Yes.
Well, I hope everyone